Hello and welcome to Church Online. As many have gone back to in-person services, we are committed as a church to continue offering you our online services. So welcome back. Back in 2020, we started discussing what we wanted to focus on for the year of 2021, and we landed on the theme of hope. And I gotta tell you that back in January, when the whole year started, I was on the fence about hope. It felt like 2021 was going to be 2020 2.0. But now as spring is here and things are getting back to normal, it honestly makes hope something more attainable for me. And I hope the same is for you. You know, we felt that the best way to convey this message of hope was to use similar elements of a story. You know, in a story, there are heroes and there's villains, there's a quest, there's a beginning, there's an end. And this month, we are focused on the main part of a story, the story itself. And we're looking at the Gospel of Luke to dive deeper into the concept of hope. The narrative behind the concept of hope lies in the gospel. The story of Jesus is the story of our hope. The story of Jesus is the greatest story ever told. And once we really understand Jesus, we can always accept and find the presence of hope in every circumstance and event in our lives. You know, what if I told you that there was a gift that God has given us, that if we use this gift and we use it often, we will become a people who are full of hope? Well, this gift will free us from living a life of hopelessness. It will change the way we see the world that we live in. Today, we're going to talk about this gift, and that gift is the gift of prayer, but more specifically, the Lord's Prayer. The Gospel of Luke has some of the most important teachings upon the nature of prayer. It is obvious that the disciples see something unique in the way that Jesus comes to the Father, and as a result, Jesus himself sees the world differently. He's not anxious. He's not filled with angst or bitterness. He's at peace in every situation, never wavering in the hope that he shares with others. And the prayer and prayer is an important aspect to why Jesus is the way he is day by day. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 11 as our main text today. And I'll be reading the whole entire Lord's Prayer as we see it also in Matthew. Luke chapter 11, verse 1, it reads, "One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples.' He said to them, 'When you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.'" You know, as we can see, Jesus was off praying as he often did, and the disciples decided to ask him to teach them how to pray. And, you know, I know as a young disciple or as young disciples and even as older disciples, we have to be taught many things, right? We got to be taught how to share our faith, how to read our Bible, how to tithe, how to get along with people. I'm not so sure that I hear much of us teaching people how to pray. You know, I remember for me, different people just teaching me how to pray. And I remember people saying, "You know, you used God in the third person too often," or, "You need to be more zealous when you pray." You know, I remember someone telling me I need to slow down while I pray. And maybe the most important thing to me that someone told me is that when I pray with others, I got to do my best, because they said, do your best not to pray looking for those mm-hmms and amens from other people. And honestly, most of the time I would often just focus on that instead of just talking to God. We may need, just like the disciples, some teaching on how to pray. Oftentimes, our prayers can be summed up as just a list of thank yous or help me's or I'm sorry's. which isn't bad. But this prayer that Jesus gives us was more proactive versus reactive. Jesus prayed this prayer. This is the prayer that Jesus may have prayed often. I imagine that as he woke up early in the morning while it was still dark, and as he went off to a solitary place to pray, maybe he prayed this prayer. You know, when he left the disciples in the boat right before he walked on water, he may have prayed this prayer. While he was alone in the desert for 40 days, maybe he prayed this prayer. He needed this prayer to get through those circumstances. He obviously thought this would be something that we needed as well. So let's break down this. Let's break this down and see how this prayer is a gift for us so that we can become a people of hope rooted in the story that God created. He first starts off with our Father in heaven. Our Father in heaven. So much to unpack in these four words. When we start our prayers recognizing who we are and who we're talking to, acknowledging that we have a Father, a strong, protective, compassionate Father who loves us, that should bring us hope. We haven't been left orphaned to fend for ourselves. We haven't been abandoned. We have a Father who has adopted us and wants to intimately know us. If God is our Father, that means we are his children. That is who we are. Understanding our identity and the identity of God is so important. Knowing all this should bring us security and confidence as we go throughout our lives. The story is that God, the Father, loves us, his children. You know, so many other stories that we hear each day confuse us of who God is and who we are. Let us embrace these roles as we pray this prayer every day. Then it says, in heaven. You know, my parents go back and forth living here in the States and living in Brazil for part of the year. And while they're in Brazil, we FaceTime often. And of course, I can't help but desire to be where they are when we talk. You know, I can see the mangoes in the kitchen. These nice, juicy mangoes. And I can hear the music and I can tell how warm it is as they're wearing their summer clothes, which pretty much is all year round. I gotta imagine this is what went on in the mind of Jesus as he reminded himself in this prayer that God is in heaven. It put on his heart the desire to be in heaven with God. You know, as he was on earth, he had something to look forward to. Why do you think Jesus wanted us to pray this prayer? I think he too wanted us to be reminded that we have a God and a home in heaven waiting for us. This should bring us hope. You know, praying this prayer this week, for me, especially this week, I have felt more stressed than normal. And it really did give me hope. This week was just full of busyness, lack of sleep, issues with one of my cars, a burst pipe in my sprinkler system, and just the daily fatigue that goes on day to day. And praying this prayer gave me hope. And it reminded me that I have a destination to look forward to, a place of eternal rest where I won't be interrupted in my sleep. I have an eternal home that hopefully has no issues with it. And all that is waiting for me. This is the story that God wants us to keep in mind as we wander this earth. All that was just in the first four words. And so let's break down some of the rest of the prayer. The next line I want to focus on in this prayer is, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, at one time, heaven and earth were eclipsed, so to speak. Heaven completely overlapping earth, and they were one and the same. But since the fall of man, there has been a separation. Not a total separation. Think about it like a Venn diagram. Two circles having parts of it overlapped. One part being earth and the other part being heaven. And the parts that are overlapped represent the coming of the kingdom. or heaven coming down to earth. You know, for those of us who are disciples of Jesus, who have tasted the goodness of his grace through faith and through baptism, we are living in the part of the Venn diagram that is in the middle, where the two parts are overlapped. But yet, there is still a large part of the earth that is not experiencing heaven, that's not experiencing the kingdom. And in this prayer, Jesus is praying and hoping that the kingdom and earth will be made one once again, would be made the same once again. And he's reminding himself that one day heaven will be completely brought down to earth, which is the will of God. And this is our hope. We get to participate in this divine plan, this divine ministry to bring heaven down to earth. You know, in the same way, just like earth and heaven, we live in a physical body, and there's a spirit, there's the Spirit of God. Two separate realities, but somewhat overlapped for those who are in Christ. And though we are not completely transformed yet, we have the hope that one day we will be made completely holy and sanctified. This prayer reminds us of this, that we are being made new each and every day. We are being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory through the Spirit. We have hope that as long as we allow the Spirit, he will bring change into our lives. We have hope that the Spirit is making us into these image bearers that we were created to be. And then hopefully, you know, as days go on, more parts of our hearts and more parts of our minds are becoming less worldly and becoming more holy. That's our hope. You know, the next line says, "Give us today our daily bread." When the disciples heard Jesus say this line in this prayer, it would have immediately drawn their minds to the story of their ancestors in the desert after the Exodus. The Israelites did not have time to gather food after, you know, leaving Egypt. They didn't have the provisions they needed to last in the desert for 40 years. And so, of course, this forced them to completely rely on God to provide for them. And that he did. Each day, God provided bread and water. You know, I imagine as the Israelites, you know, the first day, they're probably like, is this gonna happen again? But by the fourth or fifth day that this manna appeared, you know, on the ground, I gotta imagine the Israelites had to be filled with hope. We're gonna be okay. God's gonna take care of us. Here's the thing, God provided it, but they had to go and get it. They had to collect it and distribute it. It didn't just fall into their mouths. God didn't just fill up their bellies miraculously, which obviously he probably could have done. This is what God did. He provided the food, and then they had to go get the food. You know, this prayer, or this request to give us daily bread, may not seem as important to us. Obviously, most of us aren't afraid of going hungry, but this prayer has a spiritual side to it. Each day, we do need God's spiritual provisions to make it through the day. And God provides many ways to fill us up so that we can live the spiritual lives each day that we want. And here's the thing, again, God doesn't just miraculously fill us up with patience or self-control or joy. I wish that was the case. Instead, he provides us the spiritual food through the word, through prayer, through spiritual disciplines like fasting or silence, solitude, and even through the ministering of other disciples. Today, you have the hope of God's spiritual provisions. Today and tomorrow and each day, we know that we will have the spiritual provisions that we need and that we can consume that will get us through the desert of our lives. You know, the next line I'd like to cover is, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." You know, we are faced with many temptations each day. And in those temptations, in those moments that we find ourselves in, God is providing a way out. He will deliver us from those times. You know, the Bible says that we will not be tempted more than we could bear. And, you know, as you pray this prayer each and every day, you're reminded of the fact that God will. He will deliver you from those temptations. And in some ways, as you're praying this prayer each and every day, it forces you to think about the temptations that will come your way. You know, I know for me as a young disciple, I would call a friend in the morning each day and we would just think through the day. We'd say, okay, what's going to happen today? Is there any way that you could be tempted? And we would go through each and every moment and just to be prepared for any temptations. When we pray this prayer, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, we also look for the ways that God will deliver us. And we will pray those, we'll look for those, and God will deliver us. You know, this prayer, whether it be, you know, a day-to-day thing that you pray in the mornings, or maybe it's something you do each and every hour, or maybe it's just using this as a model, it really doesn't matter. I think Jesus didn't really have a, you know, he didn't really care whether this was a day-to-day thing, something that you prayed literally word for word, or if this was something that you just prayed and used it as a model. But it's a prayer that's supposed to ground us and root us in this story that God has given us, the story of the gospel. You know, my son and I, we've been reading this book together, and you know, sometimes we read it every night, and then oftentimes we go like a week or two before until we pick it up again. And sometimes we basically open up the book and we know where we are in the book, but we sometimes have forgotten what has happened. We've kind of forgotten the story. What happened again? What's going on? And so basically we have to remind ourselves and kind of look back a little bit so that we can remind ourselves. And I think prayer in a lot of ways is something that allows us to keep focused on the story. And the less we pray, the harder it is to remember this story and the gospel of and this message of hope that God is giving us each and every day. And the reality is that each and every day, there are so many other stories that are distracting us, that are causing us to forget the story that God is trying to give us. And, you know, to be honest, if we're really honest with ourselves, we are a super distracted people. We are a super distracted church. And there's so many things that are going on right now that are taking our attention away from the story of God. And this is why we need to be deeply rooted in prayer. This is why Jesus gave us this prayer as a gift, so that we can be rooted in his story of hope. Let's go to God in prayer as we are about to take communion, and let's pray that God, he will give us, deliver us from temptation, that he will give us this daily bread that we need, that he will allow us to always be thinking about heaven and how much we got this transformation that's happening, this process of sanctification that's happening in our lives, and that we can always remember who we are and who God is. Let's pray right now. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful to be in your presence. Father God, we know that you are in heaven, and we get to look forward to that one day, to be in heaven with you. And we understand that the only reason that we have this opportunity to even speak to you, to be able to approach your throne, to be able to one day, to long for heaven, is because of what your son did on the cross for us. You provided a way out. You delivered us through your son. And each day you give us daily provisions that will help us to become more like your son, so that we too can be a living sacrifice. Father God, I pray that we remember the story of hope, and that through prayer, we can always keep ourselves grounded to that story. We pray all through Jesus. Amen.